we now have something quite special planned. We have four of the major figures here in New York who are developing and building some of the tallest buildings in the city. So I would like to welcome up onto stage, and then I'm going to give a brief introduction to each speaker, to each of the panelists, and then we're going to have a 90-minute panel discussion getting into many of the issues of building tall here in New York. So I'm going to ask the panelists to join us up on stage, and then I will give the introduction once they've joined us. Could you please welcome up onto stage Gary Barnett, the president of Extell Development. Could you also welcome up onto stage Rick Clark, the CEO of Brookfield Properties. Joseph Moinian, the founder and CEO of the Moinian Group. And Larry Silverstein, the chairman of Silverstein Properties. So briefly, I'm going to give an introduction to these four illustrious guests. For people from around the world who might not be familiar with who they are and their projects, I'm going to start in alphabetical order with Gary Barnett, who, as I mentioned, is the president of Extell Development. Extell were founded in 1989 by Gary. They have a current portfolio of 20 million square feet here in the city. In terms of their tall buildings, the first of their major projects was Riverside South in the Upper West Side of New York. Which is a mixed-use project built over the Central Rail Yards complex, not unlike much of the Hudson Yards and other projects are happening on the west side today. The project which really, I think, put Extell on the map in an international arena was this project, 157, designed by Christian de Potts and Park. This project is now complete, and it was the first of the several super slim residential towers that are planned along 57th Street. And the thing that was, you know, incredible about this tower is that many of those towers were planned pre-recession, and many of them stalled during the recession. And I think it's fair to say that Gary and his team, with a large element of bravery, continued throughout the recession with this project, and it proved to be an extremely smart move because it was delivered at the start of the next upswing. So 157 is now proud there on 57th Street. And the next project, and I'm aware that this might not be the most current render, but the project has not been re-announced in terms of its current form, but it's Central Park Tower. And I think you can see from this tower and others that are developing along 57th Street that they really are reinventing many aspects of the tall building, not least the slenderness ratios, but some of the technologies that are required to make them occur at these great heights and slenderness. This project might not be the case now, but it was published as originally as being potentially the tallest building in Midtown and the second tallest building in New York after One World Trade Center. So that's Gary. Rick Clark is the CEO of Brookfield Properties. Again, Brookfield is one of the names that resonates in real estate and tall buildings around the whole world. They were originated in Canada, but they now have extensive portfolios throughout Canada, the US, Australia, UK, and probably other places that we're not aware of. So Brookfield is really a name that's become synonymous with urban development. They are the owners of First Canadian Place in Toronto. As I said, their starting point was Canada. This building is still the tallest building in Toronto and Canada, built in 1975. And perhaps their most renowned property that they now own here in New York is Brookfield Place, which is their largest continual office, retail, and other complex in New York. But the project that we're all really interested in is the project that's going on the west side as part of the developments with Hudson Yards and others. And this is the two towers again being built over active rail lines that are Manhattan West. Joseph Moinian, founder and CEO of the Moinian Group. Again, the Moinian Group are concentrated here in New York, have many properties, 20 million square feet here in New York. However, the interesting thing, or the thing that I find most interesting about Joseph and the work that he's done is his investment, not only financially, but kind of energetically and emotionally, if you like, into areas of New York that, you know, other people maybe didn't dare to tread. And I think, you know, he's developed many parts of New York and other areas, perhaps, that hadn't arrived yet. And that also extends to other cities. And I know he's no longer a co-owner of Willis Tower, which I'm going to call Sears Tower, actually. Sears Tower in Chicago. But for many years, he was a co-owner of the Sears Tower in Chicago. So they've done many projects in the city. This is the W New York Hotel in the downtown. But their current project, which is under construction, is again part of the whole development on the west side, 3 Hudson Boulevard. Larry Silverstein, and I think many people have heard of Larry, one of the established names in development here in this city and with a reputation all around the world. Silverstein Properties was founded in 1957, and again, currently has 20 million square feet underway on top of 35 million square feet already in the city. And of course, Larry's name is synonymous with the whole World Trade Center development before 9/11 and post 9/11. So many of you are going down to the World Trade Center site during Wednesday's tours. We have 3 tours going on Wednesday, above ground, below ground, and in various towers. And you will see much of Larry's work, Silverstein Properties, around that site. 7 World Trade was the first building to be delivered post 9/11. 4 World Trade delivered in 2006. And exciting plans with Bjarke Ingels for the 2 World Trade Center tower, which will be starting soon on site. But the other thing that's interesting, especially in the context of this conference and a large part of what the council does, is that, you know, we're seeing residential developments come into what have traditionally been office, you know, cores of the city, and this is happening all around the world. So this project being developed by Silverstein Properties is a combined residential hotel down in that same area. And finally, and this is really the theme of this conference, as David Malott mentioned, it's about the flow of capital across cities, which is the thing that has perhaps changed most pre and post recession. How economies and countries and cities are totally interlinked. So in the same way that we're seeing Chinese companies and Middle Eastern companies investing in the US and all around the world, that is also going the other way. And Silverstein Properties and many other companies in this room are also investing in China. So Silverstein Properties are invested in this large project in Shenzhen, China, which is underway. So we are now going to throw the conversation open to the panel. We asked our leaders from around the world to suggest a number of good topics, good questions. These guys do not have a clue what is coming up. They do, a little bit. But we're also going to open it up to the audience. So we're going to start on a few subjects which we have listed here. But I want to encourage people in the audience to also ask questions. We do have microphone assistance ready in about maybe 20, 30 minutes time when we're ready for that part. So the first question I would like to ask to all our panelists, the theme of this conference is global interchanges, resurgence of the skyscraper city, as we've explained. What has changed the most in terms of international financing for schemes in New York pre and post recession? How has the world changed from your viewpoint in the last, you know, getting on for 10 years? And I'm going to start with Gary, perhaps, to give us his thoughts on that.
Yeah, so, you know, when the recession hit in 08, I think Steve Ross said in 09, development is dead. It's an oxymoron. There's no money around. But that didn't last very long. So I think in the last several years, we've seen that the whole world really wants to come to New York City. I'd say the last 5 years we've seen a tremendous resurgence in investment in New York City. As the rest of the world, unfortunately, has become more troubled, whether it's in Asia or in the Middle East or the difficulties in Europe, everybody has realized the United States represents very stable, politically, economically, the strongest economy in the world. And New York City, of course, is the premier city in the United States. So we're seeing tremendous inflows of capital, both debt and equity, and I don't see any reason why that wouldn't continue.
Thank you. Rick?
Yeah, so maybe I'd add to that, in addition to being a safe haven, I think New York City is a great value proposition as well. You know, it is one of the few of the power cities around the world, and those being New York, London, Hong Kong, and Singapore, where we've actually seen some pretty strong economic growth and some increases in jobs, and that looks like that's going to continue for the foreseeable future. If you look at just maybe, you know, speaking to value proposition, look at a condo sales for a second. The price of a condo in Manhattan on average, I'll get this a little bit wrong, but it's roughly $2,600 a foot as compared to Hong Kong or London where it's $2,000 a foot higher. So in addition to be a safe haven, it's actually a pretty good value proposition.
Thank you for that pitch, Rick.
Joseph?
Well, Anthony, I think after 2006 to 2008, where we had the credit markets and everything came to halt, I think 5 or 6 years later, the credit market came back with a much better discipline, much better bylaws. They came back with finding formulas for making sure a project is more financially viable. Developers, architects, designers, they played a good role in making sure everything is according to the bylaws of the credit market, making sure equity and debt is well balanced. And New York was the premier and first forward city in starting such a thing. And I think because of many things, many cities in one city, that we are in New York City for art, media, finance, technology, and everything, we have a very, very good established formula. And that, I think, is the biggest difference comparing it to the other economy in, before the downturn.
Thank you. Larry, what's your viewpoint on this?
Several things. Number one, the world continues to evolve, not necessarily for the better, but one of the things we've seen is the degree of turmoil that exists in different parts of the globe has, if anything, increased the flight to safety for capital, global capital. And certainly, as has been stated by my colleagues, the New York, first of all, the United States, is the desired location for this capital. New York City is the premier city to which it's directed. And so real estate here in New York, the hard asset that people are seeking for long-term growth and stability, is in the city, making the city that much stronger, that much more vital. One of the things you see affecting financing of these different projects, the different buildings that we own, that we are constructing, while there's this flight and there's this flow of capital to New York, there's also a sense of caution that has come over the marketplace. And so when there was a time when, prior to the meltdown, rates were 65-75% financing. Today, it's closer to 50-60%. Result is requirement of more equity. Also, has been stated, the concern for sponsorship, the concern for knowledge, for capacity, for experience, the concern for equity, the concern for pre-leasing, the concern for capital in the project upfront to a degree that we haven't seen before. So it's slowly but surely you see changes in this marketplace that affects the financing of new projects. You also see the resurgence of EB5 financing, debt that is coming out of China, that is extremely attractive, that's being used increasingly by all the developers here in America and elsewhere. And so these are changes that you see and which will continue to affect our industry in a definitive way.
So, you know, just to give this a little bit more of an edge. So clearly there's capital flowing from around the world to this city because it's seen as a safe haven economically, politically, culturally. I mean, two questions really. I mean, what kind of percentage are we talking about? You know, this capital coming from outside the US, what percentage of the financing for schemes, both upstream and downstream, so for the development itself and then the sale or rental of the residential or office, you know, when it hits the market, what percentage of that is outside the US? So I'd like to start with that question. And the second question is, you know, is this 100% a good thing for a city like New York? Or actually, are there any drawbacks to it? Gary, let's start with you again.
Yeah, so I can't tell you the overall statistics for foreign capital coming to. I mean, the United States is still the largest economy in the world. And there are tremendous amounts of investment being done. I would imagine that the vast majority of investment and purchases and is being done by New York City based companies and residents, and certainly by American. Speaking of 157, nearly 50% of our buyers have been American or North American. So let's not minimize the interest of everybody in the US and in New York to continue investing in this great city. That's continuing to happen. But there's certainly a very large amount of investors and purchases coming from, and financiers coming from overseas as well, again, for all the reasons we just said. Is there anything bad with foreigners investing in the United States? I don't think so. I think it's a very good thing when people want to add capital to a market. It provides additional liquidity for us to continue building and developing, and for the whole city's tax base and income that comes in, provides a tremendous amount of jobs, high-paying jobs. So I think overall, having capital coming to New York City is a great thing for New York. I can't really see a downside in it. I do think that, you know, some capital needs to be smart, and we don't want to see people making poor investments that afterwards will come back to haunt them and, of course, create problems in the marketplace. But overall, I think it's a very, very good thing. It enhances the whole economy of New York City, and I think it's going to continue.
Rick?
This year, 2015, in the U.S., we would have, just speaking upstream, we probably will have sold $1.5 billion of equity worth of projects, or not sold. We brought partners into projects that are mature, and 100% of those were foreign investors. So I don't really know the percentage, but certainly on upstream, there is a lot of interest from foreign investors. But and I think, like Gary, I think it's a positive thing. It's the most efficient source of capital. It helps get more projects done, and I don't see anything wrong with it. Downstream. Again, similar to Gary, I think if you think of New York City alone, there's about $40 billion of sales a year. About 20% of those are considered in the luxury category, so $5 million or more. And you know, I think a very small percentage of those are actually to these international buyers that don't plan to be here that often. So I don't really think it's a problem. I mean, obviously, If the majority of your condos that you were selling in New York City were dark most of the year, that messes with the soul and the fiber of the city. But I think we're a long, long way from that. So the bottom line, this is just a very efficient source of capital for us.
Okay, Joseph?
Well, I just want to add to that. I think that we're adding, this is, the buyers are not really coming in and buying existing buildings and existing units in a big way and kind of pushing up the price of the existing housing stock. So the city is a great city, it's vibrant as it is, and we're talking about new incremental, brand new buildings that are being sold. So that's only a net plus, there's no negative in it.
Joseph, what's your view?
Anthony, you can divide the market in few different aspects. When it comes to residential, rental, I think it's like a dream for every student, foreign or US, to live in New York City. It's a place to work, play. So we're getting a lot of international students that are graduating that want to stay in New York as rental. Condominium, on the normal price market, I would say, big portion of the activity is the foreign market, especially Asia. We have sold many. On the higher price, I leave it to Gary. He has the record. He has most of the say in that market, which is great. Great work done. On the office retail, it's been majority of the growth in rental, domestic. Foreigners are renting here, yes, but not as much. In terms of finance, I think majority of the finance is coming from overseas, especially Asia and Europe. Big equity checks are coming from Middle East, Asia, and Europe. So they are intertwined with our market, those countries, and I think it's a great mixture. It's something we didn't have in the other prior economy. I think it, because we are the in-city, because we are the city that people want to live and work in, they found it very safe, they found it very comfortable. Our currency is good currency. And mixing all of that, it creates a very nice international market in New York, which helps development immensely.
Larry?
I think you're looking at a market that's become global here in New York. And it's only had, I think, a beneficial effect on everything we've done and continue to do. The city is such a magnet for interests around the globe. It stimulates our activity, it stimulates our productivity here in New York. The city has just been extraordinary. I can only see it getting better, more desirable. More buildings are going up. God bless Gary, because he started this thrust into luxury condos. And if anybody's done a fantastic job in that area, it's Gary Barnett. So I take my hat off to you, Gary. God
Thank
bless
you. Larry.
At the same time, you could see the effects of activity. Activity begets other activity. Success begets other success. And so all of this activity serves as a magnet, serves as a draw to capital sources in different parts of the globe. All of that is having a beneficial effect upon us. So I don't see it as a negative. I see it only as a positive, short term, long term.
Okay, I mean, I see it, my role as moderator, by the way, to agitate a little bit and be the devil's advocate, because, you know, this is relevant to a lot of cities. I know in my own country, in the UK, though I'm based here in Chicago now, you know, the equivalent of Carl Weisbrod in the city of London, Peter Rees, who just stepped down last year, refused to allow any residential development in the square mile that is the city of London, which is one of the financial hearts, you know, financial capitals of the world, refused any residential development for the best part of 20, 30 years. That one square mile of office space that's the finance district, the finance heart of London, has a population of maybe
2,000 people who all live in the Barbican, which was built in the 1960s. And the reason for that was he was very clear that if you were to build towers or build residential in the City of London, they would be built as safety deposit boxes for people who want a safe place to put their money out of China, the Middle East, and all these places. So the City of London booked the trend, and by the way, I'm not saying this is positive or negative, of most cities in the world, which are going the exact opposite way, of trying to bring residential into a traditional working downtown core.
I don't think that's the reason. I think the reason is that the City of London is a low-rise district. And for many, many years, he wanted to keep it a low-rise district. And if you stop building residential, you're not going to have any office space. There, as in fact, there was a tremendous shortage of office space in the city. That's why Canary Wharf got so large and developed so well and is the project it is today that Rick has been smart enough to take advantage of.
Yeah, and I think in Peter's brilliance, he also understood that the rules in London, there were sort of rights of light, shadows, and those kind of issues as well. And if you have a bunch of people living in apartments, you can pretty much be guaranteed there would have been very little commercial development. You'd have to basically get every one of them on side to be able to build an office building. So I think Peter was pretty smart about that.
But so, and then we'll move on to another subject, but I think this is important, you know, for many cities around the world. This idea of, on the one hand, someone investing $20 million in an apartment to live there for maybe 2 or 3 weeks of the year. Is that a good thing? What does it do in terms of the impact of that direct environment around the tower? And the other hand is it ever a bad thing to have multimillionaires living in the city because of what that brings for investment? So is there anybody on the panel that shares the concern that some people have about empty apartment blocks or, you know?
I think that's a ridiculous viewpoint. It's a legitimate viewpoint if you were to say that they're coming in and emptying out existing residential areas. So you have a nice residential neighborhood, people live there together, they socialize, their neighbors, and now you have you'd have people buying up those blocks and emptying them out, and now you have a gap in an existing residential neighborhood. We're really talking about brand new buildings. Those buildings don't exist. They're not going to influence the market badly. And you have to measure that against the tremendous increase in, like as you say, in having millionaires there, the money they're going to spend, all of the services that they generate, all of the tax benefits that they generate for the city, all of the tremendous amount of jobs they create. If I look at 157 in our new project, we're probably creating over the next 20 years $10 billion in economic benefits through taxes, through jobs, through everything else. So I just don't see how anyone can look at that as being a bad thing from the viewpoint of the city.
Yeah, I think, in order for a precinct to thrive, you need people shopping at stores, you need, you know, all the associated amenities to be able to survive. And there is a point, if the majority of the units in an area were empty most of the time, you would have a problem with the city, but we are so far away from that. I think it is just a small part of those that are buying the units. As I said, 80% of the units are not considered luxury, and the overwhelming majority of those are actually, you know, sold to locals.
You also have and I agree with Rick, there's a totally different set of circumstances here than what exists in London. But here you've got first of all, you have area. You have the city, and the city has this incredible mass transit system that makes the outlying boroughs available to the core. And so the ability to flow back and forth to the boroughs is immensely important. As a result, you're getting tremendous development in Manhattan itself, but you're also getting tremendous development in other parts of the city. Look at Brooklyn, look at New Jersey, look at Jersey City, look at the whole environment, the entire area. I think what we've got here is a unique mix that holds us totally separate and apart from the experience that they're having in London. I agree with the panel. I don't see any problem in that regard in affecting New York.
Well, again, those are all new apartments, it's new investments, it's new creation of jobs, new set of taxpayers that creates new income stream for the people and the city. And empty nesters or people able and liking to have a place in New York as a second home or third home, I think is as a luxury residence, I think it's a great thing for New York to have. Just like places, other places that people have different interests in. And certainly New York has a lot of points of interest for one to be investing in buying a home in New York and keeping it sometimes occupied and sometimes not.
Sure, sure. Okay, moving on to a slightly different subject now. I think what is happening in New York now, what has happened over the last 3-4 years and what is projected to happen, and I don't use this term lightly, is unprecedented in the scale of the world. And what I mean by that is where we have an established, dense, high-rise city, probably the most established, dense, high-rise city in the world. And we are seeing a new wave of development which is taking that threshold, that height threshold, to another level. And I can tell you as someone who doesn't live in New York that, you know, when I came in at the start of this conference, maybe 18 months ago, I was coming in from LaGuardia, and the first time I saw 432 Park, my first reaction was, why the hell have they let the lift core get so far ahead of the floor plate construction? Because I'd never anywhere in the world seen such slenderness, you know? And so, you know, on the one hand, we've got these new typologies, and there are buildings planned that are going to be even more slender than 432 Park. But actually, my question is not about the technology of that. My question is this. We're seeing a new breed of high-rise buildings at greater height, but equally, we are seeing the simultaneous development of huge parts of this city. We're seeing it on the west side with Hudson Yards and everything that's going on around there. We're seeing it back in the downtown. We're seeing it in Brooklyn. We're seeing it in Jersey City. We're seeing it all over the place. And my question to you is, and I can imagine what your answer is, but can even New York sustain this development? Can it sustain this level of development throughout?
Absolutely.
Let's start with Larry and work this way.
You know, you're looking at development in New York that appears to be unprecedented. But when you stop to think about it and think about office space for the moment, most of our buildings in New York are 80 years of age. Right? They're old, they're antiquated. When you recognize what New York needs today, you look at the TAMI group, the technology, the advertising, the media, the information services. These are technology companies, technology driven. They need space. They need the kind of space that is not available in these older buildings. These buildings 60, 70, and 80 years of age just doesn't exist. They need green buildings. They need buildings that provide them with all of the major services. They need space. They need densification of space. What they want to do is pack lots of people into as little space as possible. You can't do it in these older buildings. The only place you can do it is in the new buildings. And so what you've got is a constant effort to try to upgrade, a constant effort to keep pace with the degree of demand for first-class space that the high-tech companies require. Because if we don't give it to them in New York, they're going to go elsewhere. They're going to go to other parts of the country and other parts of the globe. It's important for us to stay current, important for us to be able to serve their needs, and the only way to do it is by producing these office buildings to the extent we are. So as far as I'm concerned, more is better. All of these buildings will get filled because the demand is there and the growth is there. And so from my perspective, I think we're going in the right direction. I don't have any problem with it at all.
Yeah, it probably wouldn't surprise you that I completely agree with Larry on this point, but just to put a couple of statistics around it, from the 60s, 70s, and 80s, about 60 million square feet of office buildings were delivered a decade in New York City. In the 90s, that was 10 million. The next decade, it was maybe 20. And then this decade, it looks like it's going to be about 12 or 13 million. So in the scheme of a 450 million square foot city, there's been very little development over the last several decades. And when you sort of layer into, you know, 3 to 5% of your buildings in an 80-year-old building stock just become obsolete and need to be replaced over a decade, that's 15 to 20 million feet. So right now there's 14 million square feet of office buildings under development, another 14 million that are sort of planned, ready to go when they find tenants, and another 5 on the drawing board. It's really not that many in the context of those statistics. So, you know, I think this city needs you know, more modern office product. And just, sorry, one more thing is, Midtown, which desperately needs to be rezoned, it's being worked on. If you look at over the last 2.5 years, 19 tenants actually moved out of Midtown, only one moved in. So there's a net exodus of 6.3 million square feet. Where did they go? They went downtown to these brand new buildings, Larry's buildings, or to the west side. So it just kind of shows that, you know, we need to enhance our office stock. It's very much needed.
I don't think the real estate cycle has disappeared. So I think it's a very valid question. Can we eat everything? I think the answer is we can eat everything that's been built to date. I don't think there's an unlimited demand in New York City. So just as an example, the office space that we're talking about, I don't entirely agree with Larry that people are so are looking for modern space. I think part of the story of the office market, and we should be booming, employment in New York City is way up. And the reason we're not getting, you know, across the board rents north of $100 a foot is that we really have created, technology has created tens of millions of square feet in this city simply by adaptive reuse. Everybody is using the space much, much more efficiently. And a lot of the new jobs, they actually want to go into the old buildings. We had a little portfolio in Midtown South, and that's where a lot of these guys want to go. It's an old building. You fix up the elevators, you put in new cabling, and yeah, it's not as efficient to get people in there, but they're going there. So I think that there's definitely a demand and a use for more office, but I don't think it's unlimited. And I think it's the same thing on residential as well, which, you know, is primarily what we're doing now, residential and hotels. We've seen an unprecedented boom in the market over the last 4 or 5 years. And there's tremendous amount of construction going on. And I don't think that lasts forever. There is such a thing as the real estate cycle. Markets go down, land gets cheap, construction costs get cheap. It starts recovering a bit so that you can sell it. And everybody jumps in because the profitability is good. Pretty soon land starts going up. Then construction costs start going up. And we are right now at, I think, a historic peak in terms of land values and in terms of construction costs. And that isn't going to last forever. It can't. So we'll start seeing, you know, a little bit of a correction. And the beauty about New York is that even when it corrects, it really doesn't go down that much. And that we've seen in the worst kind of recession, the worst crash that we've had, in 2008, it went down, and after 6 or 12 months, it was coming back, and it came back better than ever. So the good thing about New York City is that because of such a limited supply of land and available development, it corrects pretty quickly. It doesn't go crazy. It doesn't go down that much. And then, of course, with time, it comes back up. So I think the answer is it will not continue forever, this boom. It shouldn't continue forever. It's not good. And probably it'll, you know, weaken a little bit, it'll correct a little bit, and then God willing, it'll come back again strong.
So just picking up on that, Joseph, I'd like to answer this question then, especially for some of the delegates who are not that familiar with New York. So when it comes to the competition between these areas, you know, the largest private real estate transaction in US history in Hudson Yards, you know, is going to shift the gravity, the center of gravity of the city over to that side. What's happening in downtown Manhattan? Then, as I said, you know, in Brooklyn and Jersey City, which is in the best position? Which of these regions of the greater New York City is in the best position to come out on top when what Gary has said inevitably happens?
Well, Anthony, we have approximately 400 million square feet of office space in New York City. Out of that 400 million square feet, very small percentage are our landmark and pre-war kind of office space that everybody wants to be in. Very small percentage, very limited, all low rise, and very sexy, but not efficient. So we have cases where we own these buildings now 20, 30, or some of them 35 years. The rent per square foot is higher than what we paid for them per year. But they're very limited. When you come to being efficient, when you come to being sustainable, the game is totally different in office space. I think in order for us to keep the big tenants in New York with good design that has everything going for it, we need to have these new buildings. And it's very nice that we go around the city and we see all kinds of cranes everywhere. And we think that this is a frenzy and things are moving very quickly, but they're not. Development, as we all know, it's very complicated in New York. You need to do your homework right. It's not that easy. And if you come and start dividing up the different parts of the city, this is how I look at it. I look at downtown as now. I think if you are a great tenant, you need a big job of space, you need to move in. Whether you're located in downtown or midtown, your best choice today is downtown. There's no question. Midtown West is, in my opinion, the next 5 years. Starts from now, but if you're in a rush, there's a procedure. You have to go through a procedure, build up a building and all of that. So that's, I think, 5 years from now, or within 5 years from now, versus downtown that's right now. Now comes to the rezoning of Midtown that Mr. Weisbrot mentioned in his address. In my opinion, that's 10 years from now. A lot has to take place in order for that rezoning to take place. You have to move a lot of tenants out. You have to empty out the building. You have to merge, do air rights, do all kinds of gymnastics to be able to create something within that district, because that district is fully built right now. So it feels like we may be overbuilding, but I think all the complications of New York City development would set our schedule such that we will not be going ahead of what's needed to be built.
So Rick, you've got properties downtown, you've got properties on the west side. What's your view on this?
Yeah, I think when you look at successful urban development projects, they happen around major transportation hubs. So, you know, on the west side, with the Penn Station and the someday soon, hopefully, Moynihan Station, it's a major transit hub. It's actually more people go through that station than Grand Central Station, and in Lower Manhattan, around the World Trade Center transit hub and the Fulton Street. So I think they'll both be incredibly successful. We're seeing that today, but you know, I think we're at the point in the cycle where because of, you know, why would tenants apartment renters sacrifice the convenience of a major transportation hub to move to an outlying area? They do that for economics. It's a value proposition. So, you know, I think you're going to see some development of both commercial and more development of apartments in Brooklyn as well as Jersey City. I know for us, we're about to build some apartments in Brooklyn, which is a new endeavor for us, but we just look at the rents that we expect to charge there versus at our West Side project, it's about a third cheaper. So, you know, definitely a value proposition.
Okay, I want to start to open it up to the audience in a minute, so I will kick in with another question while we wait for people from the audience. You know, one thing that we're hearing from afar that's been a huge issue in New York, and to be honest, for me it's a little bit surprising, because these are the kind of arguments that we hear, or debates that we hear again in a city like London, where there's a historic fabric, and that historic fabric needs to be protected, and urban space needs to be protected, and tall buildings for many, many decades were just automatically seen as negative and something to be controlled, and you know, I've lived in America for 10 years now, and I don't hear that argument often. But I've heard that argument in the last 2-3 years, you know, specifically with things such as the casting of the shadows of these towers along 57th Street on Central Park, and other things, you know. It's this same kind of feeling now that New York has a heritage which deserves to be protected in it, and is at risk from these new, you know, super high towers, in the same way that, you know, St. Paul's in London needs to be protected of its viewing corridors from some of the towers happening there. So as we get the audience queued up for questions, Gary, I'd like you to answer that question first.
Well, this is a tall buildings conference, right? So theoretically, we're all in favor of tall buildings, right?
I did say it's my job to agitate a little bit.
Yeah, but again, I mean, the shadow story, I mean, we've addressed that. I think Carl Weisbrot addressed it, really. The very tall, slender buildings. And look, there's always negativity. We know that in every city in the world, as they become more mature, as people live there and get a vested interest in it, they don't want development. It's no fun, right? If you're living next door to a major project, look, I had my offices in the Belknap. We were busy chopping rock, and it bangs. You hear the noise. And that's what goes on in the city. We don't, you know, we're not in the desert. We have rock. You've got to get it out. So in many cases, you can't blast because you're in a close environment. So you're busy chopping it. It makes noise. Who likes that? It's dust. It's all kinds of inconveniences, but that's a great city. You know, New York City is relatively recent city. You're comparing it a lot to London, but London is a truly old city. New York City, if you look at, it's really the 20th century that we've seen a lot of development in there. And it was a skyscraper city. It was built at a time when we already had modern skyscrapers in the 20s and 30s and 40s. Some of our great buildings were built in those times. So we are a skyscraper city. Of course, there are residential neighborhoods that shouldn't have the character altered. A lot of tall buildings coming in perhaps would cast shadows in a primarily residential area, but we're mainly talking about in the midtown environment where it's perfectly normal to have tall buildings. Now, why do we love tall buildings? It's not just because of the beautiful architecture that they engender and the jobs they create. It's also the fact that if you want to have a great and growing city where people want to live and people want to come and work, you need to provide for them. Everybody wants to come to New York City. The youth of the world wants to come here. So if we're going to provide for that, we have to have more density. And that means a well-considered plan of large, tall buildings that can fit them. And that's why we have tall buildings. So it's very important not to let, you know, kind of the agenda be called by people who have their own personal likes at heart and don't necessarily have the overall benefit and welfare of a great city like New York.
Is there any of the other panelists who have a different view on that, or do you all kind of agree that this?
I think you're going to find it difficult for any of these panelists to have a different view.
I realize that. Okay, questions from the audience. If you could please stand so people can see you, get a microphone to you, and we got a question here, please.
Good morning. If you could wave your magic wand and do one thing to unlock untapped real estate value in New York, what would it be?
Magic wand, untapped value in real estate. What would you do? Larry, do you want to give that a shot?
I'm contemplating. But I will tell you that density continues to make a huge difference. And while Manhattan has gotten more dense, and Jersey City has gotten more dense, and parts of Brooklyn have gotten more dense, and the other boroughs, and Long Island City, for example, same thing. Ultimately, density seems to be the overall factor that challenges each of these areas, and when achieved, can make possible more people living in those particular areas tomorrow than was the case yesterday. So I see density as being a hugely important issue, with proviso for adequate parks, adequate open spaces, so that people can function, can live, can have air, can have light, and exposure that they want for their daily activities. That's my take on it.
Magic wand, Rick?
So if I had a magic wand, I'd actually wave it over transit, because I think that enhances the value of all of our real estate. You know, New York City is a very old city. Our transit needs some attention, and I would add a couple of tunnels to increase traffic flow. I'd create a train that goes directly to Newark Airport and those kind of things. I think that basically would help the value of all our real estate.
Any more magic wands on the panel, Gary?
Yeah, I'd like two wands. So as long as they're being handed out, what the heck? I think, first of all, at 157, we averaged about $6,500 a square foot for the residential. And I understand that Steve Roth is getting over $8,500 a square foot for his project at 220. So if I had a magic wand, I'd like to, I want to be Steve Roth. And then the second one is, you know, we're in the assemblage business. We assemble land and we put together different parcels, and it takes us years, and we struggle with tenants. So if I had a magic wand, I'd magically relocate all of my assemblage tenants, and I'd magically get the holdouts of properties I'd like to acquire to give me market rate as opposed to double market rate. That would unlock some value.
Okay, another more questions. The question on the front row here, if we can have the microphone. Is there anyone else who wants to ask a question? Let's get two or three questions down here as well. June Palafox from the Philippines.
Yes, sir. Thank you for sharing. I'm wondering what's the highest floor area ratio allowable right now? And then number two, the regulatory regime obtaining permits. How many agencies and signatories, and what's the cost of money for delays for mega projects? Just a guesstimate.
June, we can't quite hear you there.
Yeah.
Can you obtaining a bit shorter and louder?
Obtaining permits and approvals. How many agencies and how many signatories you have to navigate, and maybe the opportunity cost of money for every day of delay for mega tall and super tall and mega projects.
Permits and approvals in New York City.
Larry,
how many agencies? And
Larry, he wants you to distill your 50 years of development in 5 minutes.
Actually, it's 60 years.
60 years, exactly. Sorry. I just don't want you to be that old, Larry.
Go ahead. Someone else could take it.
Yeah. Joseph, do you have a...
You know, it's a very good question. We have a sizable project that we are hoping to occupy the building within the next 30 days. It's a large building. And when I was sitting down and penciling out how long it took me from the first day that I bought the first piece of land before I assemble, before I do the whole thing that Gary talked about, it's exactly 10 years. Right?
What's 10 years, Joe?
It's been 10 years.
Big deal.
So part of this, obviously, was the holdout during the bad economy. So we just waited and put everything on the shelf. But I think everyone on the panel agrees that any major project in New York City with proper zoning and entitlement in place between the different agencies and other issues that you have to cover will take something between 2 to 3 years to put everything together. Now your architects have to be very active and smart, which most of them are in New York. Your engineers have to be very smart. The people that know what the profile of the land is underneath, whether there are trains coming and going, or you have stone, or you have rock, or contamination, or you don't have contamination, all of those are different issues. But it is a process. It takes 2-3 years. So to say it financially, what kind of burden it is, if you bought the land in the right market timing and price, and you pay the full price, I would say it's not easy. If you inherited the land prior to the changes and the new zoning and the values coming up, and you own it at a very, very moderate, good, low price, that is the advantage you have over and above the local marketplace.
Okay, Larry, you want to weigh in on that?
Many large projects are today what you would call public-private partnerships. Example, I bought the World Trade Center in 01, 6 weeks before 9/11. So from the day after 9/11 to today, which is a period of 14 years, it's taken us all of this time to get most of these buildings off the ground and into a state of completion, near completion, about to be started. The final building will be Tower 2 on the signing of the Murdoch interests, 21st Century Fox, so forth. That building will go into the ground in 17, be finished in 20. So from 9/11 to 2020, will take a period of 19 years.
20 years by the time they act?
About 20 years, right? Whole 21 years by the time everything is filled up and so forth. Talk about 10, 11 million feet, talk about mass transit, talk about a park, a memorial park, talk about a memorial museum, talk about a performing arts center. All of this will have taken about 21 years from start to finish. Public-private partnership. Enormous involvement, because there, in these types of projects, you have multiplicity of governments and government agencies with which to work. And so we had, for example, 5 governors of the state of New York, 6 governors of the state of New Jersey, various mayors of the city of New York, executive directors, 5, 6, 7, I can't tell you how many. It's absolutely unbelievable in terms of number. But it's the kind of effort that's required to go in a large project from start to completion.
But there's only one Larry Silverstein.
There's only one.
Okay, and another subject, there's a hand up here. Can you just tell us who you are before you start?
I'm an architect, Eden Bar from Tel Aviv. I would like to ask you which one of your projects you love, and which one do you have regrets, and why?
Which of your own projects do you most love, and which do you most not love?
Well, we can, I'm not gonna give you address. but I can tell you, truly, you as a developer, you end up being very happy with the project and with yourself if the building is efficient, if the building is active, if the building works well, and whoever is occupying it, commercial, residential, or otherwise, are happy. The non-efficient buildings is just doesn't work. And thankfully, I don't have many, but it happens. Sometimes the building looks nicer than what the inside should be. And but efficient building is the building you always end up loving, I think.
Money is not the first issue.
Well, I think efficient building would also be financially rewarding. I think you cannot have an efficient building that you cannot have a good rewarding financial building that's not efficient. It's not, doesn't go that well together, I don't think.
I tell my grandchildren the most beautiful building in the world is a fully rented building.
Rick?
Yeah,
Rick agrees.
So. You know, and actually, I twist the question. I think it can be other people's projects as well, I guess, not just your own.
I know. We have just shy of 11 million square feet of development going on around the world right now. And I was sitting here while Joe was answering the question, trying to think of one that I dislike. And honestly, I love them all. But I think the one that we're most particularly proud of is Manhattan West. It's a 7 million square foot, very complicated building on the west side of Manhattan. And unlike Joe and Larry, we're much slower. It's taken us 30 years to get to this point. But it's underway, and we're pretty proud of that.
Okay, another subject.
Right here.
Lady on the front row here. Oh, someone over here first.
A lady's first.
Please.
Not at all. I think there are some tall buildings that are ugly, and I think there are some short buildings that are beautiful. Everything is depends on the place and the time and you know where it's appropriate. So sometimes if you know a tall building is not appropriate, but there is certainly you know a lot of great architecture that can come out of tall buildings. And if you build a beautiful building in the right place and for the right use, I think that's great. But that doesn't mean to say that they're always nice or that they're always appropriate. And height for the sake of height, just to outdo somebody else, I don't think that means anything.
Okay, good answer. Question on the front row.
My name is Bonnie Manter, and I live in New York City, and I am passionate about this city. I love your take, Larry, on some of the answers. My whole world is technology. I'm wondering, with tenant requirements today, what is driving you nuts in technology services in your buildings?
Who wants to answer that first? Rick, do you want to give that a shot?
I don't think I have a very thoughtful answer on that, to be honest. I mean, it's changing rapidly for sure, and it's impacting the way tenants use space. We think a lot about that. We've been spending a lot of time studying millennials, the group that's really driving most businesses and how they work. They absolutely work differently than my generation does. They need less personal space, but more social space and those kind of things. So, you know, we're just trying to keep up with it. I wouldn't say anything drives me crazy. It's just anticipating what's next and working it into your property.
I think one of the things we're seeing is this move toward densification of space utilization. And so they want to pack more people into the square foot and therefore effectively reduce the effective cost of rent per person. But technology is such an important part of this. It's part and parcel, literally, of everything we're doing. In the past few years, Condé Nast has come down with 1,200,000 feet. WPP has come in with 500,000 feet, that's growing to 800,000. 21st Century Fox started at 1,300,000, is now at about 1,500,000. All of this is technology driven. It's the most amazing thing.
and what they require and what they're bringing to each of these buildings is a level of technological gain that I don't think anybody visualized 5 years ago. I mean, the degree of advancement in this part of, in this area is unprecedented. And just as we're seeing incredible gains today, I think it's just a precursor to what we're going to be seeing tomorrow and the next year. I mean, the growth in technology and the effect upon all of us is beyond, at least hard for me to fully appreciate. And so I look to all our younger people. We have loads of young people who are competent in this area to give us guidance, give us direction, and give us good advice. And let me tell you, we're taking it. We're listening to them and being guided by them accordingly. So I think technology is here to stay, and increasingly so.
You know, I'd like to just play off that with what I think is a really important subject. You know, on the front row here somewhere, we have the president of Taipei 101, which was the tallest building in the world. It was complete in 2004. And in 2007, it went through a complete environmental upgrade. They spent millions of dollars, because in the time when it was designed to complete that 7-8 year period, the world of technology had moved on so much. And actually, I think not enough of our dialogue at the council actually is about post-occupancy, you know, and that's one of the biggest barriers, I think, to everybody learning what's working and what isn't working. I want to go further. I want to go further to the point of the end of life of these buildings. Because here's the reality. We now have a building on site, and it's been built by a guy in the front row there, which will be somewhere between 3,700 feet and 4,000 feet tall in Saudi Arabia. 4,000 feet tall. No one anywhere on this planet, other than 9/11, has ever taken a building down higher than 600 feet. The tallest building ever demolished, positively demolished, was the Singer building in this city in the 1960s. So really, my question to you as the panel, as developers and owners of these buildings, what are you doing to consider? Well, first of all, what do you consider the life of a tall building? And what are you doing, you know, to consider beyond the life of a tall building? Gary, I'm going to ask you to address that first.
This is my phone. I don't opine on technology. No, I'm joking about that. Yeah, I don't think we do. I don't think we're really looking at it. I think, you know, God forbid there's an emergency where you somehow have to take down these buildings, but I think the life of these buildings should be hundreds of years, and we'll worry about it then.
Yeah, Rick?
I think that's right. It, you know, as Larry said earlier, the average age of a building in New York City is about 80 years. In London, it's several hundred years. And I think it's the answer to the question is building by building. I mean, we've got a building on the west side, part of our Manhattan West project, that was built in the 1960s. It was actually a warehouse for a clothing company. And we've converted it, putting in a new glass facade, highly energy efficient new systems, and brought it up to current day standards. And it is a highly attractive building, getting almost $100 a foot. And it was just an old warehouse. So I think it's really building by building.
Joseph?
You know, Anthony, I think thinking forward, I remember, I'm in business now 35 years. So I remember New York City very different than today. And if I wanted to think 35 years ahead and focus on what advancement the last 35 years and put that into the next 35 years, I honestly see with the amount of people that are going to live here or visit here or work here, we wouldn't be able to have any buildings in New York City less than 10, 15 stories. So all of these has to be, all the non-landmark, non-valuable historical buildings have to somewhat recycle into efficient building in order to have the hotel room needed that breaks record year after year in New York, or residential buildings or office buildings or retail or all the art and fashion spaces that are needed. So with that, it's all the preparation that all responsible parties have to come together and do that, as well as the city. I think city is very focused on that as well. And it's going to be challenging with transportation, safety, enjoyment, open area, and it will be very exciting for the years to come to see this movement and advancement happen.
And yeah, if we can build it today, they'll be able to figure out how to take it down in a couple hundred years. We could take it down today too. You've got one of your sponsors is an expert in it, so.
Yeah, it is a subject to be discussed at the conference this week, but I think if we were talking about tall buildings lasting hundreds of years, I think that would, if we were serious about it, would influence the design far greater than it is currently. We have time for one more question from the audience. Is there a question here? Okay.
So we have been talking about commercial residential areas. I'm just wondering whether have you considered other sectors as well, like healthcare, education, in terms of development and in resurgence of the skyscraper city? How much would that contribute, and what's your involvement in that?
You mean healthcare and in high-rise buildings?
Other sectors of tall buildings in a particular city, or maybe New York, for that sake. Have you considered other typologies?
I think the question is about other functions in high-rise buildings. You know, we've talked a lot about residential and office, but what about hospitals and other things, healthcare in high-rise buildings?
I mean, you had Clare Water Tower in Chicago, that was an elderly care home. You have the Innovation Tower, the Maud Gaitman Tower, which is an educational facility. So do you see something like that happening here in New York to make it a balanced development, or?
I forget where, it was in Hong Kong that I remember traveling to one of the truly tall buildings, one of the tallest. It was a hotel at the top, and there was a swimming pool at the top floor, right at the top, right? You're in the swimming pool, you're looking out over the city, looking out over the world, and you're saying to yourself, my God, if they could put swimming pools up here, they could put anything up here. Hospitals, I don't see at that level. Hospitals, could they be? And healthcare, could they be? Could those facilities be included in the lower levels of high-rise buildings? Of course they could. There's no reason not. But for example, hotel utilization in any area of the building is totally suitable, as is office space, as is commercial uses of all kinds. So that would work.
I think certainly the place to look if you're interested in mixed uses is the towers happening in Asia. There are towers now with 10, 12, 15 uses within, significant uses within them. Really the concept of the vertical city. We might be able to squeeze one more quick
Hello.
Question in.
Hi, right here.
Okay.
Hi, I'm architect Shefali from Mumbai, India. In Mumbai, we are facing a lot of problems about affordable housing. I would like to know from the esteemed panel, what are their thoughts on affordable housing and how is New York City dealing with it?
Affordable housing. Joseph, you look...
I think we have, under the current government, we have a good plan for affordable housing. In fact, I think we will be very overbuilt very soon, the way it's going, in subsidized housing. There is a new discussion on the table right now that no residential building can be built unless it has a component of affordable housing. That is, of course, if you're going to the city of New York for any change in your zoning or any change in your plan that needs city approval, which gives a 25% of the footage and the keys in that project into the affordable housing. And of course, there are advantages to the developer in real estate tax abatements and other things, which are very, very valuable. But in New York, we do have a very good affordable program, which seemed to be working, and hopefully before the end of this year, it will get extended further.
I would agree with Joe. If somebody wants a zoning change in New York and they go to the city for that, I think the city has the right to extract an affordable housing component. I think that's totally rational and reasonable. You talk about poor door access. It's an amazing thing. We have a square block development on 42nd Street, directly opposite your new building. And we have about 2,200 families living here, right? So it's about a little over 400 affordable units, subsidized units. No one has a clue as to who's subsidized, who's not subsidized. People walk in and out all the time, same lobby, same elevator, same everything, totally incapable of telling one from another. So people live together, they live in peace, they live in harmony, they live well, and under the circumstances, it works very, very successfully. And so I'd say from the mayor's standpoint, is he going in the right direction? I think so.